clothes. He cares for me. My baby don't care for cars and races. Baby don't care for. He don't care for high-toned places. Liz Taylor is not his style. And even Liberace's smile. Something he can't see. Something he can't see. I wonder what's wrong with baby. My baby just cares for. My baby just cares for. My baby just cares for me.
Nina Simone. And my baby just cares for me. Here's Judy Garland. It's a great day for the Irish.
Oh, I woke me up this morning and I heard a joyful song from the throats of happy Irishmen, 100,000 strong. Sure, it was the Hibernian Brigade lining up for to stop the big parade. So I fetched me Sunday bonnet and the flag I love so well, and I bought myself a shamrock just to wear in me lapel. Sure, today is the day, March 17. It's the day for the wearing of the green. It's a great day for the Irish. It's a great day for fair. Because there's not a cop to stop a raiding. Because all the cops are out for raiding. It's a great day. Son and daughter, every good old Irish name and his relation. They come from Tipperary, Donegal and County Kerry, and they all are here to join the celebration. Now there's Terence O'Toole and his cousin Phil Doherty, Patrick O'Bolden and Michael McGrew, Mike Maley, Tim Daly and Barney O'Flaherty, Danny O'Doolin and Seamus Carew. Connie's and Donnie's and Patrick O'Bannigan, Ryan's O'Brien's, McLaughlin's and Lynch, McCones and McFadden's and Mr. Pat Flanagan, Hogan's and Gorgon's, McPherson's and Finch. It's a great day for the Irish. It's a great day for Clare. Because there's not a cop to stop a raider. Because of all the cops and operators. It's a great day for Santa. For the flag in full array. And as we go a-swinging, every Irish heart is ringing. It's a great, great day.
Judy Garland, and it's a great day for the Irish. Right, folks. Episode 16 of the Glen Midden Chronicles.
Maggie has almost forgiven the captain and Scotty for their part in making her swim around the ship dressed as a basking shark in order to satisfy the Queen. The Queen hadn't quite got the hang of her new digital camera, so the photos she took turned out blurred, and therefore the captain believes he's got away with the charade. Now the Queen wants the captain to take them to her late mother's old home at the Castle of May, which hasn't gone down too well with other members of the family.
I thought we'd seen the end of that old trout. She's not there any longer. Why on earth are we visiting that draughty old house? And you know I can't stand the fact it's salmon for every bleeding meal.
Philip! I want to visit the house. You know it holds memories for me.
Oh, more than memories. The walls hold water. That old bat never did any repairs. She was only interested in fishing.
Philip, that's my mother you're talking about.
Yes, Father. Stop speaking ill of the dead. You know, she can probably hear you.
How? Has she come back as one of your plant friends? The ones you spend all summer chatting to in the back garden? You're as loony as she was.
Mother, I can't talk to Father when he's in one of these moods. One's going to find solace in a hydrangea.
Now look what one's done.
You spoil that boy. Always have done. Anyway, you're just as bad. What about the time you got your secretary to spread the rumour that you were abdicating, just to get him all excited?
That was rather fun, was it not? However, that's not the point. We're going to be stopping off at Mother's house, and that's an end to it. One's also invited the crew of the ship along to stay for the night.
One's done what? You stupid old heifer! It's bad enough putting up with that lot in this floating frying pan. Do we have to put up with them at the house, too?
You forget. We do not have any staff at the castle. One needs someone to cook. That common red-haired girl can do it.
Oh, righto. I hear she's very good in the kitchen, and quite satisfactory in the pantry, by all accounts.
That's settled, then. Now, get one's luggage packed, and don't forget to take the free soap and shower cap. That'll do the driver for his Christmas present.
The ship docks and the excited crew disembark with the royal family and make their way to the Castle of May. The house is quite in a state of disrepair, and a strong wind blows through the rooms, making eerie sounds. This, coupled with Scotty's wind problem, makes for quite a noisy evening in the sitting room, playing Scrabble. The Queen and Prince Philip are up against Maggie and Scotty, while the captain rests next to the fire and Charles sits in the corner with a rather bedraggled-looking Aspidistra.
Thespian!
I beg your pardon.
Thespian, that's all one's letters. So let's see, that's 13 points plus 50 for all the letters, plus the word is on a double score. That's 126. What's our total score, Philip?
Let me see. 12, 25, 40. That's a total of 906 for us and 44 for our opponents.
We can still catch up with you. Didn't get all high and mighty with us. Look here. I've used all my letters and all. Here you go. R-O-A-S-T-I-T. And using down T already there.
What does that say?
Roast it, you can. I'm fair roasted sitting next to down fire.
Ah, Scotty, you see, we can show them a thing or two. It was a close scheme. That's 906 to you, Queenie, and 52 to us.
Would one like another challenge?
No, you're all right. You two are sit here. Maggie, come on. We'll hear a chat to the youngster. Oh, that's a lovely plant you've got there.
Oh, thanks. Yes, she's one of my favourites. A bit moth-eaten, but very loyal. See her juicy fronds gleaming by the fire glow. Her beautifully formed internodes and large pericaps. When she blossoms, she has the most magnificent corollas you've ever seen.
Do you not get out much, Ethan?
One's out at every opportunity. One goes out frolicking amongst nature, frolicking with the red-hot poker, snuggling with the serpentaria, dabbling with the damewort and germinating in the globularia. One's idea of heaven is cutting back an overgrown bush and finding some unexpected delight.
Aye, well, I used to do something similar, but I got arrested and banged up for 3 months.
Scotty, I don't think His Royal Highness is interested in your past. Now, come on with me, you. We have to get down to the kitchen and start preparing for tomorrow's breakfast. I need you to scramble my eggs.
Oh, this is the life. Sitting next to a big roaring fire, sipping a wee dram. Not a care in the world. Pity it can't last.
Indeed it cannot, Captain McNelson. In fact, one wanted to talk to you about the trip. One feels that one has had enough of the sea, and one is going to stay here for a while. So, tomorrow morning, after breakfast, one hopes that you and your crew will be on their way. It has been a most unusual experience, and one shall never forget it. Good night, Captain.
It's been a pleasure, Your Majesty.
I wish I could say the same. It's been a nightmare. The old trout always says things like that. Wants everyone to love her, you see. Anyway, McNelson, have a good sleep and see you at breakfast. Just got to nip down to the kitchen and see if I can help scramble those eggs.
Oh, well. Crawford, Dick, time for bed.
I think Dick's asleep. He's not moving.
Oh, look at him. Sleeping like an angel. Seems a pity to wake him.
Would you like me to throw this jug of water over him?
No, Crawford. You go to bed. I'll take care of Dick.
So, after a good night's rest, The crew make their way down to the breakfast next morning. The Queen, Philip and Charles are not far behind, and soon the eggs, links, black pudding and bacon, and burnt toast are being devoured hungrily.
Philip, pass the HP, please.
What?
HM wants the HP.
All right, here you are.
Thank you. One hopes everyone had a good night's sleep.
Well, my bed was all lumpy. The mattress has seen better days.
Don't support calling the kettle black. It's not just the mattress that's seen better days. I was probably thinking the same thing about you.
Oh, Scotty, my love, how you like to tease me in the morning over your roll and sausage.
What's wrong with your face this morning, Charles? You look like you've seen a ghost.
Well, actually, Father, I think I may well have done just that.
What are you talking about, you stupid boy?
About 3 o'clock this morning, I had to get up in the middle of the night. My aspidistra wanted a drink of water, and I was going down to the kitchen to get some for her. I saw it.
Saw what?
Nana.
Nana?
Nana, as clear as you are at the head of this table. She was walking into the kitchen carrying a 15-pound salmon.
Don't be silly, Charles. Nana is no longer with us.
But I saw her, Mother, as plain as the ears on my head.
I can vouch for that.
One begs one's pardon.
I can vouch for that. I saw her too. I have the second sight, you see. I was going to the kitchen myself to get some water for my whiskey, and there she was. She stood to her full height of 5'2", waders up to her oxters, wearing a tiara and carrying a huge big salmon in one hand and a bottle of Gordon's in the other.
Mummy!
One is doomed.
Aye, you're right there.
Following this shocking revelation, the crew made a hasty exit back to the safety of their ship. The Queen went down to the kitchen looking for any sign of her late mother, whilst Philip finished off the rest of the bacon and black pudding, and Charles hid in his bedroom cuddled up to his aspidistra. At last the MV Glenmidden can get back to normality, whatever that is. Tune in next week, same time, for more adventures from the Glenmidden Chronicles.
You have been listening to the Glenmidden Chronicles, brought to you by Cullinan.
Sorry about that, folks. I moved the wrong slider. I've got to cue them when I play them because I've got a radio station ident on them. But that was episode 16 of the Glenmidden Chronicles. There we go. Episode 17 tomorrow. Here's another track from Spike Jones and his City Slickers. And this is Chloe.
Chloe, Chloe, someone's calling.
Hello? You don't say. You don't say. You don't say.
Who was it?
He didn't say.
No reply. Nightshade's fallen. Hear him sigh. Chloe.
Where are you, you bat?
Empty spaces and meet his eyes. Empty arms outstretched.
He's crying through
the black of night. I got to go where you are.
Whether it's here or whether it's there, I want to be there wherever you are.
If it's wrong, all right, I got to go where you are.
Hello, Chloe. What are you knowing?
I just got back from a vaudeville showing.
I roam through the dismal swampland, searching for you. Cause if you are lost there, let me be that.
3, 4, 1!
And through that smoke and flame, I've got to go where you are.
Thunder, lightning, shower, snow, when I hear the call, I gotta go!
For no place can be defined.